special service. Welcome to Rob Hayman, who's a district minister, I think. You're going to lead and guide us today and speak with us. And welcome to everybody who's come here today. It's also touching on missions. We never forget them, even sometimes our focus may not be heavily on them today. So bear with my voice today. I've got my hazard collar off, so I'm still practicing singing. And if I open in prayer, I would just like to pray for the peace of Israel, Jerusalem and Israel today, from Psalm 122. And then we'll sing our first song. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we've gathered together. We've been able to be free to come and assemble on this beautiful spring morning with many things on our hearts and minds, Father, our own individual stories, Lord, and Lord, what's going on in the world and across the waves, the fact that your nation is at war, Father. We thank you also, Lord, for what's going to be achieved today, to look into our future here at New Baptist, Father, that no matter when you're coming back, Lord, we just keep sowing into your kingdom. We just keep doing your works as you've commanded us to never give up and just to keep standing firm and keep working towards your kingdom for the sake of so many who don't yet know you. So Lord, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper who love you. Peace be within your walls. Prosperity within your palaces. For the sake of my brethren and companions, I will now say, peace be with you. Because of the house of the Lord, our God, I will seek your good. Psalm 122:6. As servants of God, we also love the very stones and dust of Zion. You will arise and have mercy on Zion, for the time to favour her, yet the set time has come. For your servants take pleasure in her stones and show favour to her dust. So the nations shall fear the name of the Lord and all the kings of the earth your glory. May God arise and have mercy on Zion. May the set time come and may the time of favour come. And may all the nations under heaven fear the name of the Lord and give honour to your glory. May peace be within the walls of Jerusalem on every street and in every home and place of worship. May Jerusalem be known as a place of prayer and a place where all nations can come together and worship. May God soften the hearts of the Palestinians. May those who have lost loved ones be comforted. May the generations of violence cease, and may the sons of Isaac and the sons of Ishmael come to peace as the sons of Abraham. Sing I Cannot Tell to the tune of Danny Boy. Let's sing up and use our voices today.
Seek the wanderers with his mystery.
heard it all, am I? Okay.
So I've got a letter here from the Sutherlands, and it's a little prayer request and prayer news. They're just letting us know that this past year they've enjoyed working with the team at Overseas Missionary Fellowship, personal department out of the Sydney office. And they've taken on some extra roles, both in curriculum development and human resources. And they've come to love this precious group of people while at the same time gaining deeper insight into what goes on behind the scenes that helps missionaries on the fields and what they do. So at the end of last year, they were actually approached to take on the new role of the Overseas Missionary Fellowship this year, a role which we felt inadequate to fulfil. Mid-year this year, we were asked again to reconsider the role in 2024. With much prayer and the Lord closing and opening doors for the next year, we have peace about taking on this new role. So in January 2024, they'll finish their roles with the personal department, personnel department, and together moving into the state ministry leader role of Overseas Missionary Fellowship Victorian team. This is usually a full-time position, but they live remotely and the role will be worked. Has to be reworked. We will be in this role for 2 days a week working remotely with the team on the ground in the Melbourne offices. This will mean lots of online meetings, but it also means that we'll be travelling to Melbourne each month and staying for a few days to work face-to-face or engage with other aspects. The OMF is a shortage of that. Victoria has been without the leaders for the past 2 years. In that respect, they're excited about what 2024 will hold. And in this role with OFM as they support the team there. It's not a big team, but it's a Bonza team who have a heart for seeing the people of East Asia one for Christ. Even before starting next year, we'll be saying goodbye to one of their team members, Luba, the Victorian missionary mentor, who will return to the field to serve with her husband, and they say goodbye to her on January the 3rd. And then they'll be holding a team building day. Honestly, they say it's a daunting task for us, both with the church work and the new role. We're aware of our weaknesses and inability. The older we get, the deeper we know our limitations, and the more we understand our need for dependence on Him. Despite the trepidation, there is also much anticipation of what God is going to do in this ministry. We look forward to journeying together with this new team. We can't help but think of the Lord's words to the Apostle Paul as he battled with his own weakness in 2 Corinthians 12:9-10. But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong." And their prayer points are, please pray. Praise God for the personnel department and the work that they do that supports the missionaries in the field. Praise God for the time we've had to be part of the personnel department this year and to further the kingdom work of this organisation. Pray for Luba as she finishes up her work in Melbourne office. Pray for us as we start with the organisation and hand over work to these next 2 months. And pray that the Lord would be glorified in all through the work that they do. Mm. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. For the update from the Sutherlands. Near the end of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, Jesus brought some words to us which are very familiar. And will be of no surprise to you, but as his Sermon on the Mount was drawing to a conclusion, he said, "Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, you will find. Knock, and the door will be open. For everyone who asks receives. He who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, the door will be open. Which of you, if the son asks him for bread, will give him a stone? If you ask for fish, will give him a snake? If you then, though you're evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him?" I have a sense in which God is saying, just talk to me. Just talk to me. We don't need to separate off petition from praise and all those bits that we sometimes do, and it's right that we should do that. But I think our Lord is simply saying, just talk to me. Just talk to me. So, if I may, I'll open in prayer, and then I invite you to please feel free to speak to our God about whatever. To give thanks for the Sutherlands and the other outreach then. For all those things for which we give thanks, and to ask, and to keep on asking. In another place, Jesus said, "Nag God." Now, it wasn't exactly that word, but it's not a bad vernacular translation. Before we rush ahead, should we have some updates? Cheryl's
coming along nicely, thanks. A bit sick of where she is, but she's working hard. There you go.
And
I'm very thankful that I've been brought this far by His grace, and I'm looking forward to the next month of grace and for all our family who are journeying with us. Mm.
Annie's home.
And Annie's home. She won't join us today, but she's back with her other shoulder reconstructed. She's obviously feeling a bit fragile.
How's
Mark?
Mark Berry.
I think just
traveling,
but struggling, I think.
Yeah.
Okay.
And we've got the master of our jury starting on Tuesday.
Yes. So Gordon's last round starts on Tuesday.
Mm-hmm. And starts radiotherapy on a Tuesday,
yeah,
so
yeah.
2 weeks of that, 10 days. Of it.
Well,
on the bright side, Bob, I finished the ramp up to the front door.
Every cloud has a silver lining somewhere.
Yeah.
Shall we pray? Almighty God and our Heavenly Father, the Abba of our Lord Jesus, Sovereign God, Creator of heaven and earth, we give you thanks and praise. Your ways are surely so far removed from the way we work on the face of the earth, but you chose to join us. You chose to join us. Come and be with us as Emmanuel with us. You chose to walk a very bipolar path, great joy, great goodness, and great suffering. And you did this so that we, individuals, congregations, groups of people, families, might be reconciled to you, our Heavenly Father. For you were in Christ, reconciling humanity to yourself, and have given to us, in our differing ways, the ministry of reconnection, reconciliation, and coming home to you. Lord Jesus, you died so that we don't have to kill things to come before the throne of grace. You died for all things that separated us from our Father in heaven. Holy Spirit, you quicken us even now, individually, together, regionally and further, to know you better, Father, Son and Holy Spirit. In the name of Jesus, your Son and your Christ, Lord, hear our prayers.
Lord, we thank you. We thank you that we can come together in Jesus' name and worship here without fear of persecution, Father. I thank you, Lord, that we are able to do that, and I pray that that continue, Father. I thank you, Lord, that you are here with us here and now. And Lord, I do lift up all Israel, Father. I do pray for Israel and every single person over there that has been impacted by it, Father. And I pray your blessing upon them, Lord, and I pray for salvations. I pray deathbed salvations. I pray salvations for Hamas. I pray salvations for all, Father, that we know you know what's going on over there, Lord. So I pray that you're, I thank you that you're in control, Lord, and give you praise and thanks that we aren't. Thank you, Father.
We thank you, Lord Jesus, that we can gather together to praise and worship you. We praise you that you are the head of the church and you have all things under your control. Thank you that you are our Saviour, our Redeemer, and our Messiah. And Lord, you are the reason that we gather here this morning. And in your name we would pray for those who are sick and recovering, and we pray that you would be with each one of them and give them your comfort and your peace, and may they rest assured that you are at work in their lives in powerful ways. Lord, we will continue to pray for our missionaries and just pray that you would bless them in the places that they are, some in isolated places, and pray that they might be very much aware of your presence. And Lord, we pray for a special blessing on those who are missionaries in the Middle East at this time. We pray that you would remove fear from them and help them to trust you completely in spite of the massive turmoil that's happening in that part of the world. And Lord, we would also remember our friends at Currumburra Baptist Church and the struggles that they have at this time. Lord, we pray that you would strengthen them and bless them. Give them your peace, and may they trust you completely as they just walk this journey with you. We pray your blessing upon them too, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Father, we are so aware that believers and non-believers alike, Lord, are sensing a rapid escalation, a change in events, Lord, and we just thank you that your spirit is on the move around the world, and Lord, that so many are turning to you, and it's not about politics anymore, Lord. The only answer is your kingdom, your Holy Spirit. We just pray so, give thanks so much, Lord, for the many the young people coming out of universities and people just being moved by hearing the name of Jesus and what you have come to preach, Father. We just thank you that we can walk this journey in faith and knowing that you are the God in control, and that we have your word in the Bible to tell us what's going on to keep us in peace. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we ask for your spiritual wisdom and revelation so that we may receive from you as we meet after worship to receive from you, to hear about your way forward. Father, we ask again for a wonderful spirit of wisdom and revelation so we may walk the path that you would walk before us to your honour and your glory. And Father, we gather our prayers, our concerns, our thanks and our praise and our petitions together in the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples praying.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Sing again. Whatever happens in the world and in the Bible, back to King David, we were always taught to sing. Always sing and make music. So let's sing. His name is wonderful.
Jesus, my Lord, He's the great shepherd.
to watch something on YouTube, and then Dot and Brian are going to get down.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from hell.
Messiah, Lord of all. Father, we come before you today to bring our offerings to you for your work in this place that show how much it's important it is to us. Amen.
Jesus,
ask for
your
serene
and to the microphone.
I'm reading from my new favourite version, Passion. And there's some bits and pieces. Okay. One day Jesus taught the apostles to keep praying and never stop or lose hope. He shared with them this illustration. In a certain town, there was a judge, a thick-skinned and godless man who had no fear of others' opinions. And in the same town, there was a poor widow who kept pleading with the judge, "Grant me justice and protect me from my oppressors." He ignored her pleas for quite some time, but she kept asking. Eventually, he said to himself, "This widow keeps annoying me, demanding her rights, and I'm tired of listening to her. Even though I'm not a religious man, and I don't care about the opinions of others, I'll get her off my back by answering her claims for justice and I'll rule in her favour. Then she'll leave me alone." Jesus continued, "Did you hear what the godless judge said? That he would answer her persistent request. Don't you know that God, the true judge, will grant justice to all his chosen ones who cry out to him night and day? He will pour out his spirit upon you. He will not delay to answer you and give you what you ask for. God will give swift justice to those who don't give up. So be ever praying, ever expecting, in the same way as the widow. Even so, when the Son of Man comes back, will he find this kind of undying faith on earth?" Jesus taught this parable to those who were convinced they were morally upright and to those who trusted in their own virtue yet looked down on others with disgust. Two men who went into the temple to pray, one was a proud religious leader, the other a despised tax collector. The religious leader stood apart from the others and prayed, "How I thank you, O God, that I am not wicked like everyone else. They're cheaters, swindlers and crooks like that tax collector over there. God, you know that I never cheat or commit adultery. I fast from food twice a week and I give you a tenth of all I earn." The tax collector stood alone in a corner, away from the holy place, and covered his face in his hands, feeling that he was unworthy even to look up to God, beating his breast. He sobbed with broken heartedness and tears, saying, "God, please, in your mercy, and because of the blood sacrifice, forgive me, for I am nothing but the most miserable of all sinners." Which one of them left for home that day reconciled to God? The humble tax collector? Not the religious leader. For everyone who praises himself will one day be publicly humiliated, and everyone who humbles himself will one day be publicly honoured and lifted up. The people brought their babies and small children to Jesus so that he might lay his hands on them to bless them. When the disciples saw this, they scolded the parents and told them to stop troubling the master. Seeing what was happening, Jesus called for the parents, the children, and his disciples to come and listen to him. Then he told them, "Never hinder a child from coming to me, but let them all come. For God's kingdom belongs to them as much as it does for anyone else. These children demonstrate to you what faith is all about. Learn this well. Unless you receive the revelation of the kingdom the same way a little child receives it, you will never be able to enter in."
Thanks, Judy, for sharing that. I'm just going to preach from out here because I hate being restricted. For those who don't know, I'm Robert Hayman, the Regional Minister for Eastern Victoria for the Baptist Union. I think I've met most of you before or been around. Let me just give you a very quick update of what's happening in the Union. There's some exciting stuff. I was at an ordination service yesterday for 11 new ministers who have just been ordained into the Baptist ministry. Four of them in local churches, so some Burmese and some Chinese-speaking churches, and the other seven in various different ministries. And it's just exciting to see how the churches are going and how the union is going. It is so so wonderful to be a part of that. I also want to thank you, and I appreciate your prayers for Currumburra. And I know this church and many other churches have been praying for the Currumburra Church, who has, you know, been journeying through a very difficult time. Let me give you a very quick update so you can continue to pray in that environment. Pastor Ian Wilkinson, who was in a coma for a long time, has returned to attending church. Let me just say, it's amazing how God works. Like, nearly every Sunday, the media were outside the church, or even towards the end, in the church, just sitting. They were very careful in what they were doing, but their presence was noted. And then we had the funeral for Don and Gail, and we had the funeral for Ian's wife, Heather, about a month ago. And we all thought the following Sunday would be a media circus after the funeral. And Ian turned up to church for the first time that Sunday, and every Sunday since, the media have not been there. They've been waiting and waiting and waiting for Ian, and they gave up one Sunday to him. So, isn't that wonderful? So Ian walked in. I wasn't there that Sunday, and I was told by the interim pastor that the church just breathed a sigh of relief and exhaled. And so things are going reasonably well there. Ian himself is travelling quite well, considering. Very still weak, but is very positive in the future. So really appreciate your prayers, and the union of churches that gathered around Currumburra was just a praiseworthy point, and the offers that we've had of support. The interim pastor down there is actually an associate pastor from Crossway Baptist, and Crossway released him to work in Currumburra free of charge. Crossway continued to pay for him, and Currumburra just have an interim pastor for another month and a half, and then we'll work out what happens after that. So, you know, the Baptist family gathered and did an amazing job, and we really appreciate your prayers and support in that area. I'm going to share from you from that wonderful passage that was read to us. It's one of those parables that you don't talk about a lot, the first one that was read, because it sort of can be a bit challenging sometimes. You know, like, do we have to nag and nag and nag God to get an answer? You know, I grew up with the understanding, I didn't grow up in a church family, but when I became a Christian, I sort of had this, I don't know if it was taught to me, I don't know how it happened, but I sort of had this picture in my head of the old-fashioned scales, and that if I prayed and nagged enough and put enough weight on this side, God would finally hear me and answer my prayers. And that was the thought that I had. But it's not what's taught there. Here's a picture of a judge and a courtroom. Now, I don't think is there a courtroom in Euroa? I don't think there is a court in Euroa, is there? No. There's a court in Sale, where I live. And when the court's sitting, you know, because there are people gathering around outside, all sorts of people. You can see an array of the way they're dressed, the way they act, from those who don't really care what the judge thinks of them, and by the way they dress, to others who you can tell they're trying to dress up and look respectable, to the lawyers and to others. They're all hanging around the court. They're all all sorts of, out in the street, because the sale court has no foyer, so you have to hang around outside almost, typical country town. But the one thing they have in common is they know that as they face court, that the law will be upheld, that justice will happen, and that everyone will get a fair procedural hearing, because there are strict rules to be followed. They mightn't like the outcome, but they know it's a safe-ish place. This is not that background in this parable. This is a travelling circus where the judge walks into town, sets up a tent, and opens up for business, basically, and says, if you want me to hear your case, then give me some money. It will cost you to jump the queue. You have to have some standing in the community. This widow wants to have her case heard, and she has three big hurdles to overcome. The first one is that she's a woman. That's a pretty hard hurdle to overcome. But a woman by herself in those days had no standing. So therefore the judge is just going to ignore her. She was a widow, which made it very obvious that no man was going to stand next to her and support her. And it meant she had no money. So there was no way she could pay the bribe to the court sort of secretary to pass on to the judge so that her case could be heard. So her only choice was to walk around the tent, and if you've been camping, you know how much volume happens in a camping situation. You walk around the tent and just virtually yell out, "Judge, hear my case! Judge, hear my case!" That's the picture of which this parable finds itself. Don't get confused with walking into the county court in Collins Street in Melbourne. It is nothing like that. So the parable starts. This parable is told so that you will continue to pray and not give up. There's two options. You pray or you give up. That's the contrast that's offered to you. You either pray to God and rely on Him, or you recognise that you can't do it yourself and you just give up. Your choice. Which one are you going to do? Are you going to keep on praying to God, who also is the supplier of your need, or are you going to give up? And the parable continues in that theme of contrast. It is contrasting options. Jesus invites the hearers of this and the disciples to listen to these contrasts and to recognize them. Here is a widow who is a stranger. Just a widow. No name, no context, just a stranger. Whereas we, if we are coming towards God, we're a part of His family. We're sons and daughters. We are children of the Most High. We're not just a stranger. We don't have to rant and rave outside the tent. For we are not the unknown person. The widow, as we've said, has no access to the judge. There's no way that she can earn access. There's no way she can gather access. Whereas God's people are told that they are welcome in the presence of God anytime. In fact, they can come boldly. Boldly into the presence of God. don't hear the word arrogance there. There are some people who can think they can come arrogantly into the presence of God. They can come boldly. I'm a Defence Force chaplain in half the week, and I'm a work for the Baptist Union the other half. As a Defence Force chaplain, part of my role is to go into the CO's office and other senior personnel office and share with them what's happening on base or with personnel, or to sort of say, are you aware of this situation you need to get involved in, and give them some advice. I have no authority in that space. I am under them in authority. I'm under them in rank. But because of who I am, I can walk boldly into that place, not arrogantly. I can't tell them what to do. I'll say, morning, sir. Morning, ma'am. How are you? Can I come in and shut the door? Which means I need to have a significant conversation with you and we can't be interrupted. And every one of them will say, sure, Padre, come in. Or they might say, can you give me 5 minutes? I just need to deal with this and then we can. But I can walk boldly into that place, not arrogantly. And our same standing is with God. We walk boldly into the presence of God, who smiles when he sees us and says, come, my son. Come, my daughter. Come, my child. The widow comes to court alone. No support person, no one to stand with her, no one to back her up. We come with Jesus, our Saviour, who says, come, let me introduce you to Dad. I've been telling him about you. I've been already preparing him to hear your case because I've been asking him to intervene in it already. The Bible teaches that Jesus is praying on our behalf already. So not that we don't have someone to support us, we have the Son of God walking with us and saying, come. Come into this place where it's safe. Come into this place where you can get an answer. The widow has no promise. Not really much hope that she will get heard, let alone a positive outcome. Even with all her nagging, she's gone, there is very little chance that he will hear me justly. We walk in with the promises of God. Thank God. You promise to hear us. You promise to love us. You promise to forgive us. You promise to show us grace and mercy. That's why we can come boldly. Because we're standing on the promises of what he has said he will do. Now, whenever I get asked difficult questions, and I've got a youth group in Sale that sort of meets, and every year or so, the leaders ring up and they say, Rob, can you come to youth group and do your thing? Because I've been doing it for a while now. They go, oh, sure. And my thing is, I say to this group of young people, ask any question you like. It can be a theological question, it can be a practical question, it can be anything. And that's a scary concept for teenagers. We talk about all sorts of weird and wonderful things. All sorts, everything from creation to sex to all, you know, nothing's off the table. The first time was like, oh, yes. And then when they got to know who I was and a little bit, they just go for it. And I haven't got all the answers. But if I get stuck, I go, you know what? Let's put this through the filter of the character of God. Mm-hmm. What do we know about the character of God? And let's put it through that filter. And I find that very helpful whenever I'm struggling. But I'm coming towards God. And standing on His word, I put it through the filter of this God sent His Son to die for me. That's His character. Of course He's going to accept. Of course He's going to smile upon us. We may not like the answer, but He's going to give us a good hearing. We may struggle with the response, but He's going to listen to us. That's the promise for which we go to. This widow came to a judge in a court of law. We come to our Father who sits on the throne of grace and mercy. There's the backing of law. There is law here, but His throne is grace and mercy, not judgment. He has judgment. He has authority. He has the right and wrong. And he can say, clause 23, verse 4 says, and you ignored that, and the consequences of that is forgiveness. There are other consequences. There's practical consequences if we keep sinning. But for our relationship, there's always forgiveness. The widow comes and pleads out of poverty. And we stand on the riches that God gives us. Maybe not riches in heaven, riches in earth. You know, your bank account and my bank account may not look a whole lot of zeros at the end of it. But the riches we have, we plead out of that. So the widow and ourselves are in a totally different space. Totally different. And God is not like the judge. We've seen that. All are welcome. We won't find judgment, we'll find grace and mercy. And He answers us not out of our persistence, but because of His love and compassion. This is it's a wonderful parable. It's an encouraging parable. It's totally different to what I call worm theology. I don't know if you've heard about worm theology. God is this amazing God up there, and we are but a worm. We are but a nobody. There's a wonderful book called Mr. God, This is Anna. And it is a story of Anna who went to Sunday school. And it's a great read. Anyway, Anna comes home from Sunday school one day and says to Mum, Mum, Sunday school teacher's afraid of God. Really? Do you think he's afraid of God? Yeah, scared. Scared of God. What makes you say that, says Mum? Well, every time she teaches us something new about God, she makes us smaller rather than God bigger. And I thought, so true. We are so much more important than a worm because Jesus died for us. So we come boldly. This parable teaches us that. But the one thing I've learned in my journey, and I'm getting more and more paranoid about in my older years, is not just taking a small passage of Scripture. especially the Gospels. Like, can I encourage you to look around the Gospel? When you look at the story, what's around it? Luke put three stories together, I think for a bit of a reason. He puts this story that we've just, this parable we looked at, and he said, oh, there's another one, another story about these two guys who went to pray. He goes, you know, one was this wonderful church elder, you know, had it all together, stood up the front and said, hey, God, look at me. I know you'll look at me. I think he's coming arrogantly, but I won't say that. He's not coming boldly. He's arrogantly saying, look at me, God. I'm not like that sinner over there. I'm pointing this way because I don't want to point anywhere else. Over there. I preach a sermon like this. This sermon, I pointed out to the congregation, oh, that's bad. But I'm preaching. Point over there. I'm not like that sinner over there. I tithe. I sing with gusto. Even lift my hands a little bit, I've got it all together. I've obeyed the law. You have to answer me. That's Rob Hayman's paraphrase. There's tax collector. I think he'd read the Beatitudes. And he said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I know I don't deserve you to hear me or respond. But I know what I've done and who I am. Will you have mercy on me? If you think about it, that's pretty bold. Because he was actually coming into the presence of God knowing he had nothing to stand on, no foundation to stand on. And God said, who's going home justified? You know, in both the end of these parables, it doesn't talk about answer to prayer. It doesn't talk about the prayer's been answered. It talks about who has right standing with God. Because that's the goal, isn't it? It's not about getting your prayers answered. Because honestly, we don't like the answer to our prayers. But we go home with a relationship with the King of Kings. We go home in relationship with the one who created the world, with the one who died for us. That's the goal. And just if you didn't get it, Luke goes, oh, here's another story. Jesus was walking around and people started bringing kids, babies, interrupting this important person with little kids. But his mind has had it together. His mind has put a circle around Jesus and said, go away, you're not important enough. And Jesus goes, hey, hang on. Haven't you just heard? Did I not explain it? The kingdom of God is like this. Come to me as children, just with faith. Just their own little way boldly. If you've got grandkids, or if you've got kids, you know. These kids will just come running up to you. I visited my two, I've got twin grandchildren up in Wodonga. I've got this family of four up there. But I went up there 2 weeks ago. And I don't see them a lot, because they're 6 hours away. And I arrived after they were in bed. And I got up the next morning and I was, you know, because I'm always a bit, you know, they don't know me super well. They know who I am. We'd see each other 3 or 4 times a year sort of thing. So it's not, and when you're three, that's not that often. So I'm always a bit sort of, you know, I wonder, they might need to warm up to me, you know. And they saw me. My little heart melted because they go, Granddad! And they're running up and they attach themselves to my legs. They just come boldly. You know? They just come boldly. And that's what God invites us to do. Dad! Not only talk to you every now and again, but Dad! No thought of being rejected. No thought of not being listened to. This is the invitation that is given to us. How encouraging is that? I don't know about you, but sometimes in my prayer life, I'm going, God, this has been on my list for a long time. And I feel like the widow running around the tent, nagging and nagging and nagging. Says, I want to hear your heart. The answer may mean a lot to you. I get that, he says. But this is about relationship. He just wants to talk. Just talk to me. I just want you to talk to me. I visit my kids up in Wodonga, or when my kids come, when they live, the ones that live in Sale, I just want to talk to them. I don't agree with some of the stuff they say, let me tell you. I've got one son. Sorry, Derek, I know you won't be listening to this. But we don't agree on a lot of things. Theologically, we're a bit different. Politically, we're a bit different. But we have some great conversations. Neither of us expect to convince the other person that I know I'm right. I know he's wrong, but anyway, I know that. And he's given up trying to change me, and that's all good. But we have some great conversations. We just want to talk. We just want to do a relationship. We have to agree. God's the same, you know. The answers to our prayer may not be what we want, but it's not the goal. The goal is relationship. King of Kings. And when we get that right, we actually understand the answer to our prayers and can deal with it. I prayed and prayed and prayed for my friend Pastor Ian at Currumburra and his wife, who I'd known for 20 plus years. I prayed for them. I prayed for Heather, but Heather died. Angry with God. Do I understand why? No. I don't understand why. I don't understand how. But I understand that God called me to walk the faith like a child. And I will continue to talk to him. And I will continue to do a relationship with him. And I don't have to understand. Some may think that's a cop-out. No. It's a walk of faith. That I have faith that God knows what is going on, the big picture and everything. I say no to my grandkids. I say no to my kids. Hasn't that much effect these days, but to my grandkids, I say no. They go, what? You won't give me this or you won't give me that? I go, no. I'm not going to do that. Can't I have another lolly? Can't I have another packet of this? Can't I have another? No. Granny isn't quite as hard as Granddad, but so I just go to Granny. But anyway, you won't get in that path. No. And they don't understand. But do they love me less? No. They still come and attach themselves to me. So it's about relationship. As you journey this week in your prayer life, come to God as a child, humbly recognizing where you stand in the scheme of things. Sinner who is saved. Forgiven. Who can come boldly into the presence of God and have a relationship with Him. You're not coming nagging. You're coming just sharing your journey. Where you're at and what you would like from Him. Sometimes we don't understand the answer, but that's the walk of faith. I want to encourage you this week to never give up, because that's the option. If we stop praying, we give up and say, I'll just do it myself. Never give up on your faith with God. Let me pray for you. Father, I thank you that you accept us for who we are. That you love us just as we are. And that you welcome us into your presence as we share with you what's on our heart. May we continue to pray and not give up. May we continue to seek you, standing on the promises that you offer us. And may we recognize the right standing we have in you because of Jesus who died for us. And we give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Robert, for bringing us back to our souls and spirits. And let's sing our final hymn. God has spoken by his prophets and he will have the announcement. So much for your message this morning. It was very
Very touching. Yeah, wonderful. And we've also got the AGM coming up on the 26th of November. And if you have a prayer request, we can pray for you after we have the meeting. So thank you, everybody. And what are we doing for the benediction?
Now unto him?
That'd be great, thanks.
Father, we thank you that you are the God that goes before us. And as we go into this week, may we go knowing that you walk before us and around us. May you grant us peace, courage, and hope as we walk through this world. Because we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.